गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, वेलकम टू इंडिया लार्जेस्ट ई लर्निंग प्लेटफॉर्म ग्रेडअप एंड वेलकम टू द सेशन स्ट्रेटेजिक स्टडी सीरीज। जॉइन द सेशन क्विकली एंड मार्क यूर प्रेजेंस। आई एम वेटिंग फॉर यू ऑल टू जॉइन द सेशन। सृष्टि रे, हाय। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस समथिंग वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, very interesting, that is auxiliary memory functionality. So guys, join the session quickly. Before I start, let me introduce myself. I am Satya Narayana, research scholar with 13 plus years of teaching experience. I have mentored more than 20,000 students all over India. I have qualified GUET, SET and certified by Cisco. I teach computer organization and architecture, computer networks, operating systems, programming and data structures, algorithms. Hemant Kumar, good evening. So guys, before we go ahead, we have discussed semiconductor memory design in the last class. I have given couple of homework questions. So for you guys, I am quickly solving these homework questions. The question goes in this way: how many 256 by 4 RAM chips are needed to organize a memory of capacity 32 kilobyte? What is the answer for this? I told you the number of RAM chips is equal to total memory size by RAM size, right? That is equal to 256 into 4 bits, sorry, that is equal to 32 kilobytes. That means 32 into 2 power 10 into 8 bits divided by 256 into 4 bits. So this I can say 2 raised to 10, 5, 15 plus 3, 18 divided by 2 raised to 8 plus 2, 10. So this is 2 raised to 18 minus 10, that is 2 raised to 8. So 256 RAM chips are needed. How many RAM chips are needed of this configuration? 256 RAM chips are needed. Okay, so the answer for the first question is 256. Then this is the second question I have given. So how many RAM chips are needed? That we have already answered. That is 256. So the answer definitely would be in these two, option B and option D. The second question is, what is the size of decoder required in this implementation to select a row of chip? A row of chip, right? What is one row capacity? One row capacity. One row here is 32 kilobytes, means 8 bits. One row is 8 bits. That means two chips will be there in one row. Two chips will be there in one row. Total number of RAM chips for memory will be, we have just found out, total RAM chips required are 256. So number of rows will be 256 by 2, 128 rows. Now we know what is decoder. The decoder is 2 power n divided n by 2 power n configuration, right? We have got 2 power n as 128. then what is n? That means n is equal to log 128 base 2, that is 7. So what is the decoder configuration required? 7 by 128 is the decoder configuration. Because it is given to select a row of chip. In one row, 2 chips are there. Total 256. That means 128 rows are there. So you have to select 128 rows, any one row. Any one row. That means you require 7 bits. Isn't it? So that is 256 is the number of chips and the decoder configuration is 7 by 128. So the right answer for this is option B. Okay? All right. So guys, join PostGate guidance series to know the opportunities after GATE, which will be at 7 p.m. on the app every day, which is completely free, guys. And for computer science and engineering students, GradeUp started a new batch from 15th February, in which there will be 600 plus hours of live classes, 5000 plus practice questions, 1000 plus mock tests, 100 plus mock tests, 100 plus chapter wise study notes. That means everything that you require for cracking the GATE exam, everything will be provided in this course. So to enroll for this, take super subscription, right? If you take super subscription in the February month, there is a lucky draw, guys. Okay, so this is the series I am taking in the app, that is Data Structures Made Easy, at 6 p.m. on these dates. Today we have completed Let Us Link to Linked List concept, and day after tomorrow we will discuss bits and bytes of trees. So remember this time, 6 p.m. to attend the class on GradeUp app to become perfect proficient in data structures. And the YouTube series, which is a strategic study series, which is every day at 9 p.m. where we are discussing these concepts. This is today's concept, that is auxiliary memory functionality. And the next concept that is going to happen is cache memory. Very, very important for GATE, guys. So don't miss it. So to start with, what is auxiliary memory? We know the external memory in the computer is basically classified into two types: primary memory, secondary memory. Under primary memory, we will get RAM, ROM. Under secondary memory, this is what you say auxiliary. So auxiliary memory is nothing but what? Secondary memory. Why we call it as auxiliary? Because auxiliary says excessive. Auxiliary means excess, if you see the dictionary meaning. For whom it is excess? For CPU. For CPU functionality, this is the excessive memory. Who require this? User requires secondary memory to store his data, like songs, documents, movies, images, software, everything. But for CPU, primary memory is enough. That's why we call this as auxiliary. Under this secondary, we have got two categories: sequentially accessible memory devices. Let me write. Little neat. So sequentially accessible memory devices and randomly accessible memory devices. Here, when we say randomly accessible, it says semi-random access. That means we will be able to access any data, but not in the same time. But you can access any data. So randomly accessible memory devices here means semi-random access. Sequentially accessible memory devices we call as tapes. Like audio cassette is the best example. Randomly accessible memory devices, also known as disks. There are three types of disks, guys. Floppy disk, optical disk, magnetic disk. Floppy disk, optical disk, magnetic disk. Magnetic disk is what we call as a hard disk. That is what more important for our gate. Floppy disk, which used to be available in three different configurations: 8-inch floppy, 5.25 inch floppy, 3.5 inch floppy. In the 8-inch floppy, you will be able to store 1000 kilobytes of data. In 5.25 inch floppy, 1.21 MB of data. In 3.5 inch floppy, 1.44 MB of data. So the maximum capacity that you can put in floppy is 1.44 MB. That's why it is outdated. Under optical disks, we get CD, DVD, Blu-ray disk. In CD, you will be able to hold 700 MB. In DVD, 4.7 GB. Blu-ray disk is variable in size. Like pen drive, you have got different size, different capacity Blu-ray disk. Now, we have to focus much on magnetic disk, which is also known as hard disk. So magnetic disk or hard disk, externally if you see, externally that will be in the rectangular shape with the metallic or fiber case. If you open that case and see inside, inside the magnetic disk, you will find a circular plate which is mounted over spindle. The central location of this plate is called spindle. And what this circular plate is called? Platter. There will not be single platter in the disk. There will be multiple platters. Multiple platters will be there, mounted one over the other. Placed one over the one above the other. Centrally located at spindle. Right? Now, every platter, if you see, each platter will have two recording surfaces. That means, on this platter, on both sides, you can record the data. On both sides, you can record the data. And this surface, every surface is partitioned into concentric circles. We call them as what? Tracks. Tracks. And each track is further partitioned. Each track is further partitioned into sectors. The default size of sector is 512 bytes. Okay. Now, how the data is read or written from this? Here you will find an arrangement with an actuator and read-write arm. This is what you say read-write arm or read-write axis. One end of it is fixed here. The other end we will have read-write head. Through this read-write head, data is inserted or data is retrieved. Now, once you place this read-write axis on the disk, it can cover exactly half track. The read write axis exactly can cover what? Half track. Okay. What if the data required, the sector required is on the other half? The disk has to rotate. The platter has to rotate. For this platter rotation, under the spindle, you will have a motor called spindle motor. Spindle motor. When the spindle motor rotates, the disk attached to the spindle also rotate. How much rotation is required? Half rotation is required, because the other half read write head, however, will access without any rotation. So without rotation, the read write head can access how much? Half track. So the amount of rotation required would be, the amount of rotation required for other half track. For other half track is what? Is it complete 360 degree rotation? No. 180 degree rotation or half rotation. This is very important point. Now, we will get a doubt. How the motor knows how to, when to rotate, when to stop? How this read write head knows where, from where to read or write? For that, here we will have the memory management unit, or we say read write logic. This is what controller. So here you will have the circuit which will guide this head, motors and everything, right? Now remember, each platter is divided into two surfaces. That means equal number of surfaces. Each surface is divided into equal number of tracks. And each track will have equal number of sectors, because hard disk follow constant angular velocity. CAV. Whenever the disk follows CAV, then there will be fixed size per track with variable recording density. With variable recording density. So in the innermost track, how much you will be storing, in the outermost track also you will be holding the same. So where the density is high, less area, more volume, that is more density, right? That means the recording density is high where? In innermost track. This is also very, very important. So every platter has equal number of surfaces, every surface has equal number of tracks, every track has equal number of sectors, and each sector has equal number of bytes. Generally, what is the size? 512 bytes. Now, how the data is stored? How the data is stored? Suppose this is the spindle. Okay, this is a spindle. Now Let's say I am taking two platters. Two platters means 2 into 2, 4 surfaces will be there. Let there are 2 tracks per surface. 4 sectors per track. Just I am assuming. So this is surface 0. This is surface 1. This is surface 2. And this is surface 3. Any numbering starts from 0. Remember this. Either you number track, you number sector, you number surface. Any numbering starts from 0. Right? Now, how the data gets stored? First, it fill all the first track. Once first track is filled for surface 0, immediately next track will not be filled. Then first track of surface 1 gets filled. Once surface 1 first track is filled, first track of surface 2 gets filled. Then first track of surface 3 gets filled. Understand? So the collection of 1-1 track from every surface. Collection of 1-1 track from every surface. Like all first tracks of surface we call as one cylinder. So cylinder 0. Similarly, once all first tracks are filled, then it start filling the second track of first surface, then second track of second surface, then second track of third surface, then second track of fourth surface. So the collection of all second tracks, that is what you can say as what? Cylinder 1, that is one cylinder. So this is one cylinder. So cylinder 1. So how we can define the cylinder? So cylinder is defined as collection of one track sectors from each surface. Here one track means not any track, similar, all first tracks, all second tracks, all third tracks, and in that way. So when all one first tracks is one cylinder, all second tracks is one cylinder, and so on, then we can say what? Number of cylinders is equal to what? Number of tracks. Tracks per surface. Right? And now we will get a doubt. Sir, read write head is there on the top surface. How the data can be read or written if the data is in the surface 1, surface 2, surface 3? That's why it is not only one surface will have the read write head. Each surface will have the dedicated read write head. It's not only the top surface. Every surface will have the dedicated read write head. Right? Each surface has its own read write head. So we can say number of surfaces is also equal to number of read write heads. Prakar Dubey, yeah, it is under progress. We are also thinking of to start a new channel for CS exclusively. Very soon it happens, and you will not face any difficulty to find CS topics or CS videos. I understand, Prakar. It happens soon, very soon. We are already doing it. In the pipeline it is. Okay? Right. Now, so how the sectors are numbered, how the data gets stored, in what order, in the same way the sector gets numbered. Here you see, first four sectors are numbered in the first track of first surface. Next, the numbering continue from the next surface. Here don't see the direction, just randomly I have written this. Then it continue, the numbering continues in the next track of next, the first track of next surface. Like this, once all first tracks are filled, then the number continues in the top surface again. So this is how the sector numbering goes on. Right? Now, in hard disk, what will have unique address? Every platter or every surface or every track or every cylinder or every sector? Every sector will have unique address. So, we can say hard disk is, or secondary memory is, sector addressable. Sector addressable. Okay. Now, how many bit address it will have? So, if there are total 2 raised to I sectors, then there will be I bit address per each sector. There will be I bit address per each sector. So in our example, total number of sectors are how many? Total number of sectors in our example, we have taken 4 surfaces. Every surface has how many tracks? 2 tracks. Every track has how many sectors? 4 sectors. So there are total 32 sectors. That means 2 power 5 sectors. That means there will be 5 bit address per sector. Right? And how that address looks like? How that sector address looks like? Each sector address will be a composition of 3 parameters, C, H, S, where C means cylinder number, H means head number, S means sector number. We have just understood cylinder number will be always equal to what? Track number. Head number will be always equal to surface number. So, what this address conveys us, in which track of which surface, which sector we want. Right? So, all first tracks together is cylinder 0. So, this is all cylinder 0. All all second tracks together is cylinder 1. This is surface 0, surface 1, surface 2, surface 3. Suppose I want the address of this sector 17. It is on which cylinder? Cylinder number 1. On which surface? Surface number 0. Now, here students will not understand. On this surface, on this track, it is which sector? There are 4 sectors on this cylinder, on this surface. 16, 17, 18, 19. So, 17 is which sector? Second sector. Second means number will be 1. Similarly, suppose I want the sector address for 5. 5. It is on which cylinder? First cylinder means cylinder number 0. Surface number 1. On that surface, on that cylinder, it is second sector. So 0, 1, 1. Right? Suppose I want the sector address for 27. It is on which cylinder? Cylinder number 1. Surface? Surface number 2. On this surface, on this cylinder, it is which sector? 24, 25, 26, 27. 0, 1, 2, 3. So, its sector number is 3. Right? Now, let's say I want the sector address for 14. For 14. It is on which cylinder? Cylinder number 0. On which surface? Surface number 3. This is which track? On this surface, on this cylinder. 12, 13, 14, 15. So, give number. 0, 1, 2. So, 14 is, 14 sector number is 2. So, this is how we give the sector address. Okay. Now, if sector address is given, suppose if sector address is given and we want the sector number. Suppose sector address is given, we want the sector number. How we can find out? So, we are trying to understand sector address to sector number conversion. There is a formula. Sector number is equal to sector address CHS is given. Then how we find sector number? That is C into number of surfaces into number of sectors per track plus H into number of sectors per track plus S. So you will get the sector number in this way. Right? Now let us see. Let us verify it. Suppose I want the sector address, sector number for 101. Right? 101. So this is C, this is H, this is S. So 1 into number of surfaces, 4 into number of sectors per track, 4 plus H is 0 into number of sectors per track, 4 plus 1. This is 4 fours are 16 plus 1, 17. So what is the sector number? 17. Suppose you have got, see, 101 is sector number 17. Suppose you have got 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3 is given. So how do we find the sector number? 1 into number of surfaces 4, number of sectors sectors per track 4, plus 2 into number of sectors per track 4, plus 3. So this is 4 4s are 16 plus 8, 24 plus 3, 27. See this, 1, 2, 3 is 27. Right? At last you can just verify. Suppose if it is given 0, 3, 2. So how do you get 0 into 4 into 4 plus 3 into 4 plus 2? This is 3 4s are 12 plus 2, 14. So what is the sector number for 0 through 2 address? 14. So if you are given CHS, this is how you have to find out sector number. If sector number is given, you want to find CHS. Definitely that would be MCQ. Apply this formula on every option, do reverse engineering, because there is a standard method, but it takes more time than applying reverse engineering. Okay, now we understood how the data is retrieved from read or written from hard disk. So what is the time needed or taken to access? Here access means it may be read or write one sector from hard disk. That is what we call as access time. So let it be capital T. So this access time is combination or summation of seek time plus rotational latency plus transfer time plus controller's overhead. What is TS? Seek time. What it is? It is the time needed to reach required cylinder or track. Whom to reach? Time needed for read write head to reach. Once the required track is reached, the sector may be in this half or on the other half. So on an average, the disk should rotate for half sectors. Disk need not to rotate for half sectors. So rotational latency is what time needed to access, to reach the required sector. On that track. How you reach the required sector? With the disk rotation. How much rotation is needed? Half rotation. That's why TR is always half rotation time. Then what is TT? This is called transfer time. Once you go to the required track and required sector, then the time to copy data in or out. This is what we say transfer time. Then what is TC? This is controller's time to give signals to these read-write head motors. Logic also may require time, no? So this is the time taken by read-write logic to generate the signals. Generally TC will be very less. So if you neglect TC, that is controller's time, The access time will be summation of seek time, rotational latency, transfer time. So if nothing is given about controller's time, you can understand it is neglected. Otherwise, if it is given, definitely we will add it. Okay, so this is how we will find access time. Now let us go on to some problems. It is previous gate question. It is given that there are 63 sectors per track, 10 platters, each with 2 recording surfaces and 1000 cylinders. The address is given in CHS form. Then the address 400,16,29 corresponds to which sector number? It's a gate question. So CHS is given. Fatafat apply the formula. That is what? C into number of surfaces into number of sectors per track. Plus H into number of sectors per track. Plus S. So what is C? 400 into number of surfaces 20, number of sectors per track 63. Plus H is given as 16, number of sectors per track 63. Plus yes 29. So if you do this, you will get 505037. So option C is correct. Simple if you know the formula, isn't it? All right. Next, this is another gate question. It's given in this way. Consider a disk pack with a seek time of 4 milliseconds and a rotational speed of 10,000 rpm. It has 600 sectors per track. Each sector can hold 512 bytes. Consider a file is stored on the disk. The file contains 2000 sectors. File is stored, that file size is 2000 sectors. Assume every sector access necessitates a seek and average rotational latency. For accessing every sector, seek time is needed, rotational latency is needed. Then, what is the total time needed to read the entire file? Nowhere here controller's overhead is given, so you can understand controller's overhead, controller's time is neglected. So what is the total time? Seek time plus rotational latency plus transfer time. Now let us calculate rotational latency because seek time is given as 4 milliseconds, right? Seek time is given as 4 milliseconds. So it is given total 2000 sectors, every sector requires seek time. So what is the total seek time? (2000 × 4) = 8000 milliseconds, because it is given in the question every sector requires seek time. Okay, now we need to find rotational latency. How do you find? It is given 10,000 rotations can be done in 1 minute. That means one rotation can be done in 6 milliseconds. Right? We know TR is equal to half rotation time. So that means what is TR? 3 milliseconds. This is per sector. So what is total TR? Total rotational latency. Total how many sectors? 2000. So 2000 into 3, that is 6000 milliseconds. Right? Because it is given every sector requires secant rotational latency. Now, we want transfer time. So we found seek time, rotational latency. Now, if you observe, one rotation, one complete rotation means 360 degree rotation means what? One track. So one track to cover, it requires 6 milliseconds. One track means how many sectors? 600 sectors to cover 6 milliseconds is needed. The file size is 2000 sectors. So 2000 sectors require how much time? That is 2000 by 600 into 6. So that is 20 milliseconds. Right? So now total T is equal to TS plus TR plus TT. That is 8000 plus 6000 plus 20, that is 14020 milliseconds. So the right answer is 14020 milliseconds. Okay, Chandrasekhar, good evening. So this is how we understand auxiliary memory functionality and we proceed for the questions. Guys, as I said, in the February, if you take super subscription, you will get a chance to win smartphone, smartwatch, scooty, laptop. So take super subscription, guys, and enjoy the structured live course access along with these benefits also. Right? So guys, we are the faculty, Malesham sir, Murali sir, me, Ankit sir, Navneet sir and Anshul. Who will be handling all the courses. This is our 2020 trackers record, achievers record. 60 plus students achieved in top 100 guys. So we are very proud to say this. So take super subscription and enjoy all the structured live courses taught by best faculty. Get the green card access with which you will be able to access, attempt all the online mock tests. So I have kept two homework questions. Please take the screenshot of them. Let me count on 5 for the screenshot. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Next question. This is also homework. Solve and come in the next session with the solutions, guys. We will discuss the solutions in the next class. So take the screenshot. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. That's all for today. Next class, we will discuss cache memory. Cache memory is a big topic, so we will discuss it for 3 days. We'll start this on Monday. So guys, try to circulate about this strategic study series as much as possible. Let many people benefit out of it. Okay, so a gentle reminder about the series happening on app, that is Data Structures Made Easy. This is the session that is going to happen on Monday at 6 p.m. And in our strategic study series, we will be discussing cache memory at 9 p.m. on YouTube. That's all for today, guys. Thank you so much for joining. Good night, everybody. See you on Monday. Till then, have a happy weekend, great weekend. Prep smart, score better, go grade up. Bye-bye.